and welcome to this week's Movie Math, where remember a couple of weeks ago in the trades, Hollywood was all like, whoa, we think we're going to have a horrible summer at the box office this year? Well, apparently, it's because they were operating with insider information that they'd made a bunch of crap. You know how to best avoid having a bad summer at the box office? Make some good movies, which is kind of the theme of today's Movie Math. But the trades, on the behalf of Tinseltown, because, you know, that's they're preaching to the choir, they made a good effort to try and shift the blame to two other parties, all right? So the first one was Memorial Day and how it's been ruined as a moviegoer weekend. Why sit in a movie theater, they argue, well, this is how they feel moviegoers feel, when you could be outside in the sun, right? Well, come on, it's a four-day weekend. Who doesn't want to take a break in an air-conditioned movie theater with a nice fizzy soda and some snacks? I mean, summer, there are a lot of things to associate with summer, but one of them is boredom, and movies alleviate that boredom. That's what they've done throughout history. And speaking of history, here's a little history lesson for you. Well, it's selective history. I'm going to fill it out for you. But the trades pointed out that the last weekend in May used to kick off the summer movie season. But that all changed back in 2002 when Sony shifted Spider-Man to the first weekend in May to get out ahead of Star Wars Episode II, which interestingly enough didn't open for that Memorial Day. It opened the weekend before. But still, the summer release schedule has never been the same since. And on a side note, Disney has the first weekend in May and Memorial Day locked down, not just this year, but for the next 2 years. Although they better make sure those Star Wars movies are actually good, because they're shifting from the now proven Star Wars release date of December to the shakier Memorial Day weekend. Shaky? Didn't Hollywood just say this was a dog? Well, if you're going to talk history, as I said, you have to cover all the history. And if you look at past Memorial Day weekends, movies that have a favorable image have done well over the Memorial Day weekend. And some of them have even been franchise installments. Very late franchise installments. Well into the franchise, which really disproves Hollywood's favorite current refrain of franchise fatigue. That's something that they're basically all wearing on a t-shirt right now. Also, I think that we've proven now without a doubt that if a movie is hot, people will see it no matter when you release it. So that's the first thing they tried to shift the blame onto. The second is old Rotten Tomatoes, all right? So the trades say these are popcorn movies. Critics aren't meant to decide if they're good. And I would counter that a critic-proof movie is 60% or higher on Rotten Tomatoes. Maybe I'll go down to 50%. That's where moviegoers will say, you know what, I'll still take those odds, right? Like, that's not a great number, 50 to 60%, but still, I'm willing to bet that it's a big franchise. I'll still have a fun time, even if it's not a quality movie, right? Perfect example, Indiana Jones and the Kingdom of the Crystal Skull. Not a particularly well-regarded movie, but it's still got a 77% on Rotten Tomatoes, which is kind of weird when you think about it. I guess there's some argument to be made that Rotten Tomatoes was still finding its power at that time. And maybe, you know, to some degree, it was just the idea of Harrison Ford returning to the role that, you know, gave it a little bit of a cushion. But still, 77% on Rotten Tomatoes, and that resulted in a $100 million opening on Memorial Day weekend 2008. So that worked. Interestingly enough, same screenwriter for Pirates of the Caribbean, Dead Men Tell No Tales. But when you have a Rotten Tomatoes score of 32% or 19%, people just aren't going to take that risk that, you know, they would have still managed to somehow have a good time in spite of that rating. Now, what a lot of the producers and stars of these films this weekend have been arguing is that, hey, the Rotten Tomatoes score is low, but the audience score is high, you know, when they poll people when they leave the theater. But here's the thing. With those Rotten Tomatoes scores, the only people still paying to see the movie are inclined to like it. So that skews the audience score, and it's not as accurate as a Rotten Tomatoes score where you have a wider collection of tastes, so to speak, forced to see the movie because it's their job, right? It's very similar to what happened with audience reviews. I used to do audience reviews, as you might recall. I would interview people when they came out of the theater. And one of the reasons I discontinued it is that every movie was getting a high score because that's who would pay to see a movie at 10 a.m. on a Friday opening day, right? I mean, people who were, unless a movie was just absolutely horrible, people tended to be favorable toward it. Also, if people don't like something, they don't want to be stopped to discuss it. So they didn't want to be interviewed, which would also affect the audience score. And maybe it affects it here too. Maybe if people are like, that was horrible, they're like, you know, I don't want to stop and fill out this ballot. But if they're like, oh, I liked it, I want to support The Rock, I'll fill out the audience score. So I don't think those numbers can be totally trusted, particularly in this situation. So I think that the actual reality of what happened is that Rotten Tomatoes warned casual moviegoers that these movies were too risky to put into your holiday plans, right? And then also, moviegoers at this point have been conditioned successfully to choose other things besides movies to entertain them. That's just the harsh reality. So it's not so much that movies used to be critic-proof, it's that they were the only game in town. They used to have Habit and Holidays to help them out. But now movies have to really just basically rely on being quality. Oh, the horror! They actually have to make good movies. They don't have this cushion anymore. And I still, as we've been discussing on Movie Math for the past couple of weeks now, the key to Hollywood rebounding is the exact same thing that made television so hot, and that's writing. And interestingly enough, when we were discussing the recent writer's strike, it was all about TV writers having the power and film writers still being stuck with absolutely no power. But you know, hopefully, we'll see. The foreign box office is going to slow down this realization, you know, from Hollywood, because that's their current cushion. You know, they're not the only game in town in the United States anymore, but they seem to be the only game in town in China. All right, so anyway, now, one of you actually wrote, you know, when I was reviewing these movies last week, I'm so upset that Hollywood didn't give me a movie to see this holiday weekend. And if you were just, you love going to the movies and you were like, that's it, I'm going to see a movie, it's part of my weekend holiday plans, it's tradition, then if that was the case, you picked Pirates of the Caribbean, which is what won the weekend. Why? Well, it had a PG-13 rating, which meant that everyone could go and see it. And often on a holiday weekend, families are going to the movies. So you need to be able to take the kids, you need to be able to take the grandparents, and the raunchy R rating for Baywatch was a major no-no. And then also with Baywatch, since it just, it crumbled so quickly with, you know, with the worst of the two Rotten Tomatoes scores, and then also Dwayne Johnson gave momentum to that by saying, oh, the critics are out for blood, and then, you know, the score's too harsh. And then in turn, to get him back, all the same outlets that gave it a harsh score turned around and said, oh, look at Dwayne Johnson trying to save his movie because it's so horrible. So basically what happened is that I would say Friday morning, it became clear that nobody was going to see Baywatch. And so if you're going to sit through a bad movie, you want to sit through a bad movie that's crowded, Pirates, rather than sit in an empty theater and watch a bad movie like Baywatch. So I think that was a big factor as well. And so because of all that, Pirates might be leaking, but it's still afloat. It's actually quite buoyant. Again, thanks again to the lifeline that is the global movie-going marketplace. Get this, it made $208 million overseas this weekend, 67.8 alone from China, where it had its world premiere. Very savvy, Disney. It had premieres in LA too, so it's crazy, but they had a really expensive, big, elaborate premiere in China, got a lot of publicity out of it, and they were rewarded with a big chunk of change. So that means that Pirates had a $270 million global debut and is still on track to make $800 to $900 million overall. Talk about failing upward, right? So, and also, as Disney was very quick to point out, their franchise has now passed $4 billion in total in box office revenue. That's amazing. So the big question for Disney is, do they just lazily let this continue to circle the drain and make as much money as they can while they can? Or do they try to fix it a la Transformers? But then again, I don't think Transformers looks particularly fixed, do you? They're like, oh, we totally changed it and repurposed it. We have a writer's room. And you're like, it still looks a lot like the old Transformers. But the old Transformers was pulling down $1 billion a picture. So I think that Hollywood, at the end of the day, you have to remember the studios are a business with shareholders and bottom lines. And so they're like, if it's still making $1 billion, let's not touch it. And so they might feel that way very well about Pirates. But here's the big, an even bigger question for the other studios who are hiring Johnny Depp. Is he a problem? Is he a liability? Disney is still very much in the Johnny Depp business, and it has mixed results. But how about him being Grindelwald in Fantastic Beasts? Although Fantastic Beasts did quite well, but very little Johnny Depp in that movie. But he's going to be all over the sequel, but maybe, who knows, maybe Jude Law will bail him out. And then also he's the Invisible Man for the Dark Universe franchise that Universal is now launching. Will he be a problem there? Although he'll be invisible, so who knows? It's really, he has a very interesting career right now. It's like, nobody wants him there, but nobody's, it's like we're all like playing chicken with Johnny Depp, right? He's like, I'm not going to get any better. You're like, well, I'm not going to stop seeing your movies. And I don't know what's going to happen. We'll see. And then as for Dwayne Johnson, he has a question to answer too. And that is he an R-rated movie star or is he a family movie star? I think he wants to be an R-rated movie star. And I get it. It's sexier, right? It's a lot like ingenues who are like, I don't want to be funny. I want to be sexy. And then they kill their careers, right? We've seen that happen a number of times. And I think Dwayne Johnson is like, I don't want to be a family movie star. It's not cool. But it's like, how'd you like to not be a star at all, Dwayne? How'd you like that? I think that would be the worst case scenario. I mean, forget overexposure. I feel this is his real issue. I saw it start to happen with Central Intelligence with his social media posts. I think Kevin Hart is a very bad influence on him. And some of you pointed out this was very much what his persona was like when he was a wrestler. And this more family take on Dwayne Johnson, emerged when he went to Hollywood. And I think Hollywood was right to package him that way. And I think someone's just going to have to sit him down and say, I'm sorry, if you want to be a movie star, you're going to have to be a family one. Get over it. All right, so overall for the top 10, not only did Vin Diesel enjoy some karma this weekend, but so did Neil Blomkamp. Because Ridley Scott, of course, personally killed Neil Blomkamp's Alien movie, saying, it's Ridley Scott's, like, no joke. He's like, it's Ridley Scott's Alien, not Neil Blomkamp's. And it's like, Ridley Scott's Alien Covenant dropped 70% in its second weekend, which is really bad. Typically, blockbusters in their second weekend drop somewhere in the 60s. So if it's low 60s, you're in good shape. If it's high 60s, that's unfortunate, but it's not outside the realm of, you know, normal. But 70? 70 is horrible. Even with its lean budget now, it's looking at just maybe breaking even after advertising costs. Because, you know, the budget is lean, but it costs, remember, we've discussed this before, it can cost anywhere from, like, a low budget advertising is about $20 million, but for a big blockbuster, it can go up to $100+ million for the advertising. Alien Covenant wasn't that expensive, but I'd still peg it around maybe a $60 million advertising cost. So one of you said, oh, I think I know what's happening in the next Alien. Sigourney Weaver's going to show up. But I wouldn't be surprised considering the current trend of old is new in Hollywood, right? I mean, that if I were Fox, that's what I'd be doing right now as well. But will Ridley Scott stay on? After all, he said it's Ridley Scott's Alien. But what is Ridley Scott's Alien considering these box office returns, right? Although I think he's going to have to quit on his own because when it comes to damaging his image, he seems to have a very high tolerance. The biggest headlines this weekend, though, besides the beach bums of Hollywood, were for holdovers. And Fate of the Furious became the sixth movie of all time to make $1 billion overseas alone. That's incredible. And on the flip side, it made just $222 million domestic. And this is why lazy franchise filmmaking continues. But then again, I liked Fate of the Furious. I thought it was actually quite a good movie. But the real issue here is that it's money, because again, money drives Hollywood, that decides if a movie's going to continue, if it's a success and if a franchise should continue. And clearly, foreign audiences are where most of the money is coming from these days. So that's a huge change. That for in large part, it would be the Chinese audience that renders the ultimate verdict on a film. But everyone loves Beauty and the Beast, which now has a comfortable 10 million lead ahead of the Fate of the Furious. You might recall that last week I said Fate of the Furious could maybe boot Beauty and the Beast out of the top 10 pretty quickly. I don't think that's going to happen now. I think Beauty and the Beast will stay there until maybe Thor Ragnarok, maybe Wonder Woman. We'll talk about Wonder Woman in a moment. But also Last Jedi, those movies, one of those will probably kick it out. But still, it's in there for now, and it just became the eighth film ever to pass 500 million domestically. That's amazing. I hope that helps it with its Oscar chances, its awards chances. As for this coming weekend, the movie gods have truly blessed Wonder Woman, as the tracking has increased significantly from before to almost double to $111 million. Why? What happened? Well, Warner Brothers really amped up its publicity, to their credit. And also, they released their social media embargo about 2 weeks ago at this point, and it seems that Wonder Woman will have a very strong Rotten Tomatoes score at her back, and that's really what everybody is counting on at this point. That number will actually emerge tonight as the embargo lifts at midnight Eastern Standard Time. But there are still some hurdles to go. The DCEU reputation, a female lead, which historically they've had some problems at the box office. And then also, while Pirates 5 and Baywatch won't be competition at this point, have they broken the movie-going habit already for the summer? Are people already used to doing something else with their weekend? But anything over $100 million for Wonder Woman would put her in league with Hunger Games and Star Wars when it comes to top female actioner openings. Even if she were to just come in at 85, that would be phenomenal. But I, at this point, and having seen the film and knowing how good it is, I think anywhere from 80 to 100 is what I would guess. It's very exciting. Are you going to see Wonder Woman? Oh, I hope so. I hope you have your tickets. If you do go, you can be featured on Movie Math next week, because I'm going to do another ticket montage. There are instructions over on Twitter on how to participate, and also down below in the video description. So that's this week's Movie Math. Thank you so much for tuning in. Please write down below, I think, this weekend's box office, and also, of course, how you feel about the upcoming Wonder Woman release. Thanks for watching.